This is In Bootcamp, Episode 4, Catch 'em All, on Friday, February 8th, 2019, with your hosts, Matthew Petchel and Ryan Rampersad. You can find the show notes for this episode at thenexus.tv/IB4. Hey.
Hey, guess what?
What?
Week 4? Week 4 already. We are 1 month into In Bootcamp.
Wow, and you're 4 weeks in to your actual bootcamp.
Yes, and isn't it funny how that works?
It is kind of interesting how
but
that works.
1/6 of the way through the program now.
That seems like it's gone really fast.
It has for me, and I don't really feel like I am
1/6 of the way done.
What I've done anything, really.
1/6 of the way full of knowledge.
Yeah, I kind of feel empty-ish, kind of, but not really. It's been a lot of fun learning, you know, mingling with classmates.
So you're 1/6 of the way done, and so this is a 6-month program, so it's 1 month. That's how that works.
It's how it works.
So I would wonder if a person who's taking the regular... the speedy version, the 3-month version,
3 months.
Every day of the week. I wonder if they would think the same thing at this point. Do they feel like they've gotten a lot of progression out of their program, or is it just because it seems so spread out for you that maybe it feels a little bit more diluted?
Yeah. Which, I don't think I could handle the full time.
Well, right, not in your situation, but I wonder if it's just the pacing difference. But you know what might make a little bit of difference in your situation?
Oh, yeah?
Well, the weather of the last 2 weeks has been kind of insane.
Yeah, class has not physically been held yet this week.
Yeah, so last week we had extraordinarily low cold temperatures.
Yep, minus 58.
Yeah, which is cold. And then this week we had extraordinarily frequent snowfalls.
Yes. And on Saturday it was 40 degrees and rainy.
And then everything was iced over the next day. It was great. Highly recommended.
It's been insane.
So some of that, class time disruption certainly could play a role in some of your.
No,
you don't think so?
I at all. We have a strict schedule that has been set by the curriculum makers, and
well, it's not as if you're missing content, but not being in class certainly can take an impact on how you think about it.
I suppose, yeah, but just going off of the projects and in-class exercises and stuff.
Mm-hmm. So for those who take this class in a non-wintery area or time of year, how does your remote class work? So what is that like?
Okay. It varies. We have this Zoom box thing. I guess you've used it when you talk to your... consultee or
friends from Brazil.
So when Ryan talks to his friends from Brazil, he uses Zoom, and it's kind of nice. And we've also used Hangouts once.
Oh, that's interesting. I would have never expected Hangouts.
Yeah, but the thing about Zoom is he would break up the class every like half hour, like, okay, we're gonna do this in-class activity, everyone, you're gonna be in a breakout room of 6 people, and then it's just like, okay,
and then it takes 10 minutes for everybody to get in.
No, it never took that long, but then it just takes that long to figure out, all right, who wants to share their screen? And I'm not sharing my screen with you. You guys are weird. And
well, okay, so if you did share your screen with them at home, do you use your laptop or desktop?
Oh, my desktop, of course.
Oh, so then you share 8 screens with them.
Yes. You know, I don't know why that is, but it is that way. So I run Ubuntu at home, and for
on your
some
desktop.
Reason, on my desktop. And when you share a screen, you can normally pick a screen that you want to share. For some reason, the way it's being served...
Window managers.
Yeah.
They're senseless.
Just, I have 5 monitors hooked up. And if I turn off a monitor, like, I actually have to disable them, and I'm not doing that because it took me forever to get them centered the way so I can drag a window across.
But amusingly, even when you disable them in software, it still doesn't care. It'll just show you black.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you get to use Zoom, which is really good. And you get to do some class activities and you get to lecture. I feel like that seems pretty safe, pretty good.
Guess what though? Nobody has a nice mic.
Yeah, I've heard that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nobody cares about integrity of sound quality.
Well, and we are a select group here, of course, where we do And you are now part of that group because you have a real microphone at home as well.
ATR 2100.
Well, that's the best mic.
And we're doing, it's the official mic of this podcast.
Yeah, except for the two mics that are rogue right here.
Yeah, and they are off for that one reason.
Well, they're not off. They're just not getting streamed in.
Yes.
Yeah. So let's talk about what you actually have been doing. So last week, you started JavaScript.
Yep. It was just the basics of the basics. It's, you know, var. And if.
And four.
What?
Four.
No.
No four?
Or did we do loop? Yeah, I guess we did loops last
Saturday. A few loops here and there.
A few loops.
So that's a good start. And then what did you do this week with JavaScript?
Well, on Tuesdays, we were all about functions and objects and...
Can you tell me about a function and or an object?
Well, I could talk to you about object because we talked quite a length. So you have a key and then you have a value, but they call them properties and other things, and it's...
Oh, yeah, you did ask me a question about this.
Everything's got a word in CSS. This is the attribute. This is its whatever. Yeah. And then it seems that the thing is, the instructor kept on flip-flopping. And I'm trying to learn his vocabulary. And
so you'll find that a lot, because a lot of the terminology that people use, especially in this subset of the industry, JavaScript is extremely self-taught. Whereas .NET or Java might have a little bit more enterprise cruft on top, which means that there's some more common lingo that's get used. People in JavaScript land might just make up terms or use the terms they read about when they learned.
Hmm. So, yeah. Did you teach yourself JavaScript, I'm guessing?
Yes.
At what, age 6?
13 and a half. Yeah.
That is because you are a superstar.
No, it's just because I wasn't making other life choices when I was 13 and a half. So functions. What did you learn about functions? Just how to write functions?
Yeah, just how to do functions and function calls.
Like, you learned about how arguments worked.
Passing them in. Things inside the argument don't have... You have to use this and blah, blah, you know, blah. So a little bit of scope, a little bit of
okay,
that.
Okay, that's good.
And,
like, did you learn arrow functions at all or just regular functions?
No. Okay. And so we're still using var. And var. So var has, what, function level scope, and, like, let and const have the block level scope. We haven't talked about any of that yet, so...
Yeah. That is a shame, I would say, and you've said this to me before, like, you don't know any bad habits yet,
yeah.
So why teach you bad habits now? We can introduce you, and I think it's valuable to be introduced to how things were in the old days, or, you know, previous iterations of code, but, like, I think when you say, like, don't teach bad habits up front, I think that really rings true in my mind.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so I've been supplementing this course with other things,
Googling MDN.
Well, MDN uses let for everything. Or no, actually, a lot of their examples just use const for stuff. But,
which is the righteous thing to do.
Yeah. I don't see var. I only see var in my course material and stuff. And, you know, I can't see the future. Well, because they don't let you work ahead. So
we'll see. I mean, hopefully they do introduce ES6, let, const, arrow functions, and spreads, and all sorts of good stuff. Hopefully they do introduce all of that.
Yeah. And then on Thursday, we started the jQuery.
The jQuery. And so tell me about jQuery. Like, when you think of jQuery, what do you hear? Like, what does that mean to you? What do you think it is?
Well, see, I don't know a whole lot, so I'm very impressionable. I listen to what other people have to say and stuff, and I was always like, jQuery is legacy crap and blah, blah, blah. You don't need to know it. Vanilla JavaScript can do everything for you now. And it's like, because all we've done right now is, like, you know, you get an element by ID, like, oh, I have this paragraph tag. Well, I want to, you know, change it. I want to append its context and all of its other things, blah, blah, blah. And then they're like, you can use JavaScript to do that. And you can manipulate the DOM with JavaScript now. Well, I mean, you always could, but now people are saying you don't need the jQuery, but then you're like, well, guess what? The internet was made on jQuery, and there's a lot of legacy stuff. And in the industry, you need to know jQuery still.
Yep. So like we were just saying, like, you don't know bad habits yet. So I would say just go and learn all of the normal DOM operations like you should. But I can see the perspective of the class writer.
Yeah.
Okay, let's use jQuery, because it's something that you'll almost certainly see and experience at some point.
Both Vue and React are coming still.
Cool.
It's not like it's just a jQuery class.
So for me, because I lived through jQuery 2000s. And MooTools and then Angular and then Vue and then React, it for me, it's good for a person to know all of those things, or at least know of them, because the industry went through a transformation of people having ideas and, you know, attachment to each one of those different libraries. So it's not like knowing them is bad. It's just maybe you don't need to know right now.
Yeah, and it's, like I said, we're only 1/6 of the way through.
Right, so there's another 2 weeks of jQuery.
Well,
I hope not.
I don't actually fully know what's coming ahead, because...
So you actually had a question for me earlier this week.
I did.
Which was, is jQuery an industry standard?
Yeah, I did ask you that one.
In 2019 and beyond. And so my answer to the question was, when I started working in 2016, my first big project of a team of 12, we were working on a front-end, back-end microservice application. You know, full stack, databases all over, microservices all over the place, Java-based, Spring-based. The front-end, though, was probably the least developed part of the system, though.
Oh, really?
Because prior to me arriving, there weren't really any other front-end knowledgeable developers. And so I knew some Vue, I knew a little bit of React. Of course, I knew MooTools and jQuery and, you know, all those general things. I'd never worked, though, in a professional capacity before. So I was able to help bring in some additional, like, tooling and stuff for that team, which was really good. But we were basically stuck with the tech decisions that had been made prior to that, which was, we're going to use jQuery, and we're going to use Knockout.
Knockout? That's a new word for me.
So you can kind of think of Knockout as, what if you wanted to make Vue.js, but in 2010?
Ooh.
And so they did some tricks, and it uses the concept of observables, and you know, it works, but it's also just not a very robust or pleasant to use library, not like Vue or React is today. But it's interesting because we use jQuery as a major component of the entire system on the front end back then in just 2016. And so there's software, million-dollar software being written in 2016 using jQuery. I mean, it's worth knowing, I would say.
Okay. So the answer is yes.
Yes for now and probably for a while. Yeah. And then another funny thing that I'll mention, you learned Bootstrap a little bit.
Yeah, and now we've already moved on.
And so Bootstrap today, Bootstrap 4, even today, its default configuration when you pull it in through NPM, which you know about, but your class doesn't.
No
packaging amusing.
Manager.
When you pull Bootstrap in, it requests that you also install jQuery for it. It's using the latest version of jQuery, like 3.2.1 or something, but it's still using jQuery even today. So I always find that amusing. So the day...
Is that why you use Yarn?
No. So the day that Bootstrap doesn't request jQuery is the day we are liberated.
I see. And I told you about our slides, right?
What?
Our slides for jQuery?
No.
Or not, for Bootstrap?
No.
Twitter Bootstrap.
Oh, yeah. It is Twitter Bootstrap.
It is Twitter Bootstrap.
That is pretty funny. I never think of it that way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I got my grades back for my second project.
That's good. And, so your first project was a little portfolio.
Yep, and the second one was to make two forks of that. One of them was a, just you changing your styles sheet. You added a bunch of media query selectors.
Yep.
So you broke at like 400 pixels, you broke at like 960 pixels, and you broke at 1,000 pixels and stuff.
Yep, it's a little responsive.
A little responsive, and then we also had to do it with grids with Bootstrap.
Nice.
And as we started the show with all the weather and all the other stuff, I really, really rushed through the Bootstrap part. Screwed it over. I'm still trying to learn everything. So I bring up my style inspector, or I bring up the inspector. I can see, like, why are all my styles not being applied? Because you can see them. You can see, like, I am setting the color to this, and it just got a line through it, and I couldn't figure it out. I'm like, you know what? Just screw you, Bootstrap. I am too dumb to learn you, and I submitted it anyways. So I submitted some broken crap. Oh, God, an A.
I mean, it was the effort.
Well, I'm wondering if it was an HTML, like, so for the Bootstrap one, my style sheet was completely screwed up.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess the HTML worked, well, because it did. I mean, when it was on, like, extra small and small,
right, so your styles might have been broken, but the Bootstrap style still worked.
Yes.
Yes.
Because I guess they have higher speciality or specificity. I don't know. I can't speak English. You're just glaring at me. I don't know why it broke, but I'm just glad I got an A somehow. I'm a straight A student so far.
That's really good. I'm glad to hear that. You will have many years to know about Bootstraps. Don't worry too much about that right now.
Yeah, because it's not going anywhere.
Yeah. Let's see. What else do we have here? So you were talking to me earlier this week about some people not knowing how to even attempt at debugging their code.
Yeah. There's a lot of people in the class who are just moving along with me and everything else. And then there's
some stragglers, of course.
Stragglers.
And so what were they straggling in?
Well, one of our first things was to, you know, pick a website and open up Inspector Tools and then just start mutilating the crap out of it. Like, change the background, make it say funny stuff, make it say poop. Just, you know, you can edit stuff that way.
Yeah, the dev tools are amazing.
And there's the console log and stuff. That's still when people out. People can't open it sometimes.
Yeah, and so do you think it's because it wasn't explained well, or they're not connecting the dots?
They're not connecting the dots because they opened it. They've done it. I physically went over and touched their laptop and opened it up, and it's like, okay, FNF12, go there, do blah, 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 and it's still not syncing
and
in.
It's not registering there.
It's like whenever they go home and sleep, they reset.
I feel like some people must do that.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Well, so you did community education and stuff, and you told me about the people who would have a notebook that would just go, like, file, like, they'd write down the whole path trees of everything else.
Yeah. And so for some of that, it's a mindset shift.
Oh, that I don't know anything, the computer's smarter than me, and I have to follow these exact instructions, and I can't think for myself.
And if I do anything wrong, I'll break it.
But then you get a new one if you break it. It's always been my mindset.
I know, I understand, and especially with...
And new is always better.
And new is often better.
Hey, guess what? So, everyone out there, it's 2019, and my mom just bought an Ivy Bridge i5.
It's not old at all.
It's not old at all. Because you can still buy brand new stuff. Or certified refurbished.
Yeah. So, what is your new project now?
The new project is the first project that we've had freedom. We can do whatever we want. We are to make a game that played Hangman or something Hangman-like, and we're supposed to come up with a theme for it. But I don't like hanging people.
So for context, for all the listeners who don't know what Hangman is...
Hangman.
It's a game where you normally draw a stick person, and you draw a body part, I guess?
Yeah, until you draw the whole body, and the guy is hung by the neck till dead.
Which sounds really morbid when you describe
it. It is incredibly morbid.
And the way you lose, I guess, is for each body part drawn, it corresponds to a missed opportunity to guess correctly a letter of the word in question.
Exactly.
Wow, what a weird game. Why do people play that?
Yeah, and so my version, with my creativity, I am a avid Pokemon fan, and so...
Says the person wearing literally today, in front of me, a Pikachu shirt. Yes.
I am very proud of my Pokemon love.
And you're wearing the yellow headphones. Wow, you match.
Pika P. Moving on. So instead of hanging something, you enslave them when you type the word correctly. So, what it's going to do is it's going to pop up a picture of a Bulbasaur. If you spell the word Bulbasaur correctly, you catch the Bulbasaur.
That's really cool.
And if you
don't,
the Bulbasaur runs away.
That's really fun.
Yeah.
So you gave me a little sneak peek of this a couple of days ago.
Yeah, it's due on Tuesday. It's not done yet.
You have time. It's fine.
But the core of it's there.
But when you told me the concept, I thought, wow, this is fantastic because Hangman doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, it's just I've never liked word games because I've always sucked at them, like Scrabble and other things.
So one of the fun things that I did when you showed me your prototype was I Googled GitHub Pokemon list of names.
All 802 of them.
And I found a gist of all of the Pokemon names ready to paste into an application for whatever reason. So enjoy that.
I start it.
Yeah, enjoy that.
But no, it's for the first time we can do something that reflects us. We don't have to meet these identical criteria and everything else.
And so I would say inevitably you'll put this on GitHub if it isn't there already.
It is right now.
I would say, like, remove any mention of it. Like, don't make it look like classwork.
Oh, yeah, like, the README file doesn't even have... It just says Pokemon in it.
Good,
like,
yeah. Pokemon game.
The first two, the README files, are just what my instructions were.
That's fine. But for this one, like, this one might go into your portfolio because it might actually be good and somewhat real.
Yeah.
And I think it's a lot of fun. It's unique. It's novel. Sure, it might be blatant copyright infringement, but
sorry,
it's still
Freak.
Fun.
Sorry, Nintendo.
They deserve no praise.
But they do deserve my money.
Yeah, they do. For Pokemon only, though. So, do you know what might be coming in the Saturday class next week at all? Guesses?
More, as far as I can see, it looks like more JavaScript.
So, when do you think you'll be ready for, like, you've done a lot of front-end work. Like, when do you think you will get your first touches on back-end work?
I have no idea, but the next big section change will be February 23rd.
So a couple weeks from now.
Yes, we have Ajax coming up.
Okay, so there is some opportunity soon for there to be some more interesting content. So far you've only done front end and very basic front end at that. So you'll have some good opportunities coming up for something new.
But a lot to look forward to, and so all you listeners, stay tuned and listen each week.
That's right, because there's a limited number of these. So you got to listen to each one very carefully.
Yes.
There's a quiz at the end.
The quiz is you have to make your own quiz and evaluate yourself on how well you listen.
Yes, and you know what you can do to that? You just eval. It's a joke. It's a JavaScript joke. So where can we find you on the internet?
You can find me everywhere on the internet that has... my name on it. I'm not very well known. I don't have the Twitter that everyone else uses.
But you do have Twitter.
Yes,
actually.
But it's not like it's real.
But
you've tweeted more than I have with my own account.
You could choose to make it real.
I could choose to use it.
You should use it.
Could join the 123 million other people who actively use Twitter.
So, for example, here's all you have to do to start.
Oh.
When you go into class next time, before anybody else arrives, because I know you're always there early.
Not really.
Take my word for it.
Yeah, okay. Wink, wink. I'm the first one in the door like a teacher's pet.
Take a picture of your classroom and post it on the Twitter.
Oh, I do that.
Good.
Well, I take pictures of people's things and people and
just post a picture of you at class in the Twitter.
I think I can handle your extracurricular assignment. That said that...
Don't even try. Hey, you can find me just about everywhere, but especially on the Twitter that is real at RandomR, and of course on my own website, RyanRapperset.com, which is where I have updated my work log as of late, because I have been doing fun things like going to MiniHack and helping students learn cool stuff about JavaScript.
It's almost like you're good at about expressing your brand.
Yeah, something about branding. Mm.
Man, you got it down.
Got it down. I'm wearing a blue shirt, even though the brand's red. Wait, two blue shirts. Well, one's teal, maybe.
Yes, we'll go with one's teal and one's blue.
Yeah. So that's all we have for this episode.
Yep, and we'll see you later.
Have a good one. The Nexus.
The Nexus.
The Nexus TV.
Podcasts from the technological convergence.